late 1860, South Carolina was the first state to secede from the United States. After a convention, the state released their reasoning for leaving as primarily increasing hostility on the part of the non-slaveholding states to the institution of slavery. It was felt that the lax enforcement of the Fugitive Slave Act infringed on their state's rights. Shortly after the secession of six other southern states, a Confederate constitution was formed prior to the Civil War. Along with alterations to the original Constitution, which gave states more power over the federal government, such as the ability of state legislatures to impeach federal officials, the consensus over the issue of slavery was that it would be protected at all costs. After the Civil War, many in the South became part of the movement that is the Lost Cause and claimed that slavery was not the main cause of the war. They were known to deny writings of Confederate figures in support of slavery, such as the cornerstone speech made by the Vice President of the Confederacy, which said, "Slavery subordination to the superior race is his natural and normal condition. This, our new government, is the first in the history of the world based upon this great physical, philosophical, and moral truth." Sparked by the death of Robert E. Lee, monument associations, as well as the Commonwealth of Virginia and City of Richmond, funded the Confederate statues that still remain today on Monument Avenue in Richmond, Virginia. At the time, the proportion between black and white people was nearly 50-50 in some areas, and from the years 1890 to 1929, monuments of Confederate leaders Robert E. Lee, J.E.B. Stuart, Jefferson Davis, Stonewall Jackson, and Matthew Fontaine Maury were unveiled.
This is probably one of the most virulently and actively racist pyramids of our culture.
The horror of slavery has not been fully realized by the average person. A textbook in Virginia that was used up until the 70s, that basically said, the blacks were happy.
You read newspapers over the course of the 20th century. The reverence for Robert E. Lee and that statue is phenomenal.
The monuments clearly represent different things to different people. And when they went up, that was the case.
This was a period when they were rewriting the Constitution. They were passing a law called the Racial Integrity Act. People in Virginia, in Richmond, white people in Virginia, in power in particular, were actively saying they wanted a white society that was hierarchically based on race.
There was a black newspaper, The Planet, and they came out with flyers that they posted saying this is a bad idea, this is just going to fracture our society.
One of the things about Richmond's landscape is that until very recently, there were almost no monuments or public art that represented the black history of Richmond.
In 1996, a statue that still remains today on Monument Avenue was built of Arthur Ashe, a professional tennis player who was the first African-American to ever win the singles title at Wimbledon. After his tennis career, he was also a writer and anti-apartheid activist. His was the first statue on Monument Avenue that's purpose was other than to memorialize the Confederacy, highlighting controversy both nationally and locally.
I initially thought Monument Avenue would be a bad idea as a location because I didn't think it would happen in Richmond. That there would be too much objection. And from both the black community and the white community, more information came out about the Confederate history and how people felt about the monuments. And the question changed. Initially it was, should Arthur Ashe be on Monument Avenue? And it changed to, why shouldn't Arthur Ashe be on Monument Avenue? The more that people learned about who Arthur Ashe was and what he did after being a world champion twice at tennis, and about the 8 books that he wrote and his quiet political activism, people began to understand him more as a hometown hero. This is the only sculpture that I know of that was essentially designed with the input of the person who's memorialized prior to their death. And the books, being in a warm-up suit, having children involved in the presentation, most significantly, he said, I don't want to be the center of attraction. The last thing he said in our conversation which was about 10 minutes, was I suppose a tennis racket should be in there somewhere. One of the suggestions is that the monuments come down and they go to the Confederate Museum, or to just a museum or a place where you go to see those sculptures. My thinking on that is that it's kind of like disciplining a child for, you don't want them to watch a certain television show, so you don't let them watch any television.
As an artist, part of your job in engaging the public sphere is to process how the public is interacting in that space and how it's relating to its history and to that moment in time when that sculpture goes in and how it's going to engage with it over time. And I also profoundly believe that no matter how strongly you may feel about it, I don't think anything is sacrosanct.
The purpose of art, especially public art, is to get people to think, is to get people to consider other points of view, and is certainly to represent history.
I don't think that that we should say that because these went up and because they were beautiful pieces of art, that is the only criteria for their existence in the public sphere.
So are the monuments offensive to some people? Yes, they are. And should further context be added? Yes, I think it should. Should they be taken down right away? I feel like we had this argument in 1994, 95, 96, when the Ash Monument went in.
I think that there are places that are appropriate for it. I think that they are worthy of study. I don't think, it was never my thought that they should be destroyed. It was simply that they should be relocated to a place where they can be put in a context in which they can be understood for the totality of the history.
And at one point, I did feel like they should come down. And then that the Confederate monuments, or I felt that taking them down and leaving the bases up would be an appropriate statement. It got me thinking about what about having just sinking the monuments so they wouldn't be as high.
Hollywood Cemetery is a place with lots and lots of room that came about in the antebellum Confederate period. That most of the people who were buried there were part of that history and that culture. And so, yes, those seem like appropriate spaces for them to go, as opposed to continuing to stay in a place that means that we want them to represent us in public life.
The director of the Virginia Historical Society, Charlie Bryan, has written numerous times publicly, been published in the paper and elsewhere, that slavery was the reason that the Civil War was fought. That's in a sentence.
There's not sort of this understanding of a long-term presence of Black people in this city, that they have been a part of it since its founding. And when we talk about that, we talk about slavery. So there's no real strong sense of continuity in the presence and contributions and trials and achievements and resistance. All of these components of life that Black people participated in, whether they were enslaved or free, this is not something that you can readily see in the landscape.
People who haven't really, who have an opinion, but it's not necessarily a deeply considered opinion, I think that's where you begin, is what qualifies a person's opinion. And if it's just based on what they've heard or what they've grown up with, an opinion needs to be expanded.
But what I can see in retrospect, but also because I was here at that time, it seems to have been the first time that there was a real debate over what Monument Avenue means to the city.
The shock, really, of Charlottesville, for me, the initial shock anyway, was seeing Confederate flags sold as souvenirs along with Nazi flags. That that's a group mentality that one would think we got over. Now, it doesn't mean that if you are proud of a Confederate flag that you also embrace a Nazi flag. Gandhi said, the enemy is fear. We think it is hate. It is fear. And I think that sums up people being afraid of what they don't know.
With different time periods, meanings change, and so should context. Some say soldiers of the Confederacy were simply protecting the right of states to secede when they felt wronged, while others say they were protecting the institution of slavery. These Confederate figures represent white Southern heritage and rebellion to some, and slavery to others. The actual question is, what do we represent? As a city, can we value both the inclusion of blacks and the heritage of whites? During the era of the monuments, neighborhoods were zoned by race. Even after the end of segregation, white flight was still prevalent. Race is disproportional in Richmond public schools. We are still divided, scared to have the conversation. When the context we find ourselves in changes, so will the symbols, in this case, the statues that represent us. The symbols won't change until we decide what they mean to us right now. No one wants to forget that the monuments existed. We all just want to see them in a context in which they make sense. Educate yourself. Talk to people you're afraid to talk to. Really listen to them and try to empathize. And then maybe we can have a conversation where we decide something. Then maybe things won't be so black and white.